for one of the few times in his career, David Haye will not be the favourite for this. He's only, in actual fact, a 4-6 outsider. That's where he'll be when he climbs through the ropes. Vladimir Klitschko is a 7-4 on favourite. But, you know, in this gym, they don't care very much about odds, because this man over here was a 3-1 outsider 3 weeks ago when he took on James DeGale to win the British super middleweight title and add it to his Commonwealth. For this, and that's unusual for him. Does he enjoy the kind of underdog status or not?
I'm pretty sure he will, Craig. I think he's been there before with a few other opponents. He's definitely boxed abroad, gone to foreign territory to pick up the title, so little things like that won't bother him. You have to say Vladimir would be the favourite for this fight. He's the one who's been at heavyweight longer, but David's got, like me, he's got other plans.
Yeah, I mean, he's a kind of brooding presence in this gym, isn't he? Vladimir Klitschko. David likes to have images of all his opponents when he has his workouts. There's Nikolai Valuev there, and I suppose a lot of people saying, yes, because David beat a 7-foot guy in Nikolai Valuev, you know, what's the problem in taking on Vladimir Klitschko? But this is a very different test, isn't it?
Yeah, very, very different. They're totally different fighters. Vladimir brings a lot more, a lot of different questions that David will need to answer, but him and Adam have put together a fantastic strategy, and they will be on top form in a couple of weeks' time.
Well, let's talk strategy, because it was a tactical victory for you, George, if you like, against James DeGale. Now, you tried out things in the ring in a major title fight for you that you maybe wouldn't naturally do in your career. Is David ready to do the same thing? Could Adam come up with a battle plan and that has David box completely differently from the way he's boxed before?
You know, the game plan is always something that me or David will be able to do. We identify our strengths, we identify our weaknesses, and the same with our opponents. And then we come up with a strategy which works, you know. And it's not as black and white as you have to do this, let's get it done. We come up with what works and we test it out in the gym, and it sort of grows organically. And then you start putting it into sparring, putting it in on the pads. And then when the sparring partners are getting buzzed and they're struggling, you know it's starting to work. And Dave is definitely looking in top condition.
Yeah. Can you give us any little insights into how the sparring is going? I mean, has he done anything spectacular, David?
Yeah, you know, he's been more than spectacular. And as a fighter, I'd like to be humble for his sparring opponents, because I think they've been struggling very much with David. And,
well, he's decked a couple of them, has he?
Yeah, he has. Yeah, he's been buzzed a few, and a couple of them hit the deck. So there's always nice signs to have in the camp. You obviously need to ignore that once you get in the ring, because none of that counts for nothing until you actually get in there. But it proves that he's well on his way. He's totally focused. He's in that sort of last final straight period of training a couple of weeks ago. Really put his foot on the gas, and I'm pretty sure he can't wait to get in there now.
Yeah. I mean, the psychological byplay in this fight is very interesting. Vladimir keeps on demanding that David shakes his hand. David doesn't want to do it because he doesn't want to do what Vladimir tells him to do. The latest thing Vladimir's been saying is, I want you to wear that T-shirt with the severed heads of the Klitschkos. Now, I suppose if David does that, everyone will say, well, he's tasteless, but he has come out with this poster.
This is actually not Vladimir Klitschko. This is called the Russian.
Right.
And no, you can buy this. This is an app of David's that's on iTunes at the moment.
Fair enough.
And you know, maybe some people might put two and two together, yeah. But that's it's a fun app. I've tried it. It's good fun, and I think it's just David showing a bit more of his personality. That, you know, he's a fun guy. He's an interesting guy, and he's not frightened to push the boundaries a little bit.
Yeah, because Vladimir has been trying to make him out as the bad guy in the run-up to this fight, the guy with no class, who's a bit tasteless, who doesn't have manners. But I mean, when you're in camp with him, and if you know him a little bit, you do see a different side to him. And what did he do for you in the run-up to the DeGale fight? You were out in Miami together, and how closely did he work with you? What amount of time did he devote to your cause?
Yeah, 100%. I was out. He was like a big brother. He was, you know, I stayed to live with him. You know, he made sure I got to the gym on time. He made sure he helped me out. He was in my corner for sparring. And, you know, that's when David's obviously training, but he wasn't quite in fight mode. Like, when we see him usually in the press, he's in fight mode. He's got his opponent, you know, three seats down from him, and he's fully focused, and it's about getting in their head mentally before the fight, because that's always an advantage. So, you know, us as fans watching that, we think we know David, but, you know, that's one side of him. There's many other sides to him, and he's a really nice, genuine guy, and I feel especially after that Miami camp. We was out there together for nearly a month, and he really looked after me and made the world a difference for me in the lead up to my big fight.
Yeah. Having said that, this is a step up, I suppose, as the gear was for you as well. When you look at some of David's recent fights, yes, he's won a heavyweight title against Valuer, but if you look, say, I don't know, the John Ruiz victory, I mean, the Audley Harrison victory as well, can we really say that, judging from that, you can be full of confidence for him to go and meet a seasoned champion like Vladimir is, who's at the top of his game? Are we talking about this as being a big step up again?
It's definitely a step up, no doubt about it. But I feel like, you know, when this fight was first made 2 years ago, David was new to the heavyweight scene. And although he obviously he's been in with Valuev and then Ruiz, he dominated, and the same with Harrison was almost a no-show. But he spent 2 years as a heavyweight now, training as a heavyweight, sparring with heavyweights and living like a heavyweight. And that's what makes the difference. It's not necessarily the actual fights that's the be-all, end-all. So now I feel he's in a lot stronger position than he was back then. And I feel he's the best in the world in the heavyweight division.
Yeah. Just before we finish, and this gym's going to fill up with media because it's an open training session today, can you quickly show us maybe a couple of the bits of equipment that David's been using?
Sure. The favourite bit of equipment that we haven't seen at the moment, well, you might have seen at the moment, is the VersaClimber.
Oh, yeah.
Everyone's having a go. Craig will be on it soon.
I don't think so. That's not going to happen.
So we start with, for a warm-up, we're doing minutes, how many you can get out in a minute. Yeah. And then once you're actually doing rounds, we make it specific, 3-minute rounds, 1-minute rest. Yeah. And the target is, at the moment, the record is after 10 rounds. But El Santos is 678. But Ruben, the actual conditioning coach himself, has set the bar at 828.
Right.
Which you've done this week, so improvements across the board, Craig.
Okay, fair enough, that's interesting. I noticed that Adam has got those, I don't know if we can pop round here quickly, because has Adam been using these famous boots?
He's been using them out of the gym more than in the gym, Craig. as you can see, they're starting to get worn down, where he's had them on so much.
He brought these in for the value effort. This is so he can hold the pads up at the level for the opponent, and, you know, it's a, you know, again, Vladimir is what, 6'6", 6'7", so, you know, David punching upwards again, but he's used to that by now, I suppose.
Yeah, he is, he's more than used to that. His arms and shoulders are very well conditioned. Adam's had him on to do the pads. We've also had some huge guys in to help David wrestling and on the body pad and stuff like that, just so he's in there with a big physical presence.
I could use these for maybe interviewing Vladimir Klitschko, to get the right eye line, that would be quite
handy. Adam, I'm sure he's got a contact for
him. Fair enough, but we've also got Karl Froch, just finishing off by talking about your prospects. Karl Froch is going to be coming down today to take a look at training with David. I mean, how far away do you think you are from maybe meeting him in the ring?
I mean, Carl's at the top of his game. He's world champion. He's where I want to be. And I know I need to put in a lot of work before I get there, but by the back end of next year, I feel I'll be ready to make that step. So, you know, I'm not going to say, I'm offering out Karl Froch now or Andre Durrell or Andre Ward, any of those top fighters. You know, it's going to be important for me to get back in the gym, work hard, and because I want to get there.
Okay, good stuff.